Back. Back and let's break MD4. So I hope you had a look at the paper, because I'm not going to go through the entire thing, but just through the motions of how the thing like works essentially. So the paper presents a differential cryptographic attack. So essentially a way of observing how hashes behave on the two sides of the compression function and finding paths, things that when conditions that are either always true or bits that can disappear into a function. So essentially what the paper gives you is, given a block N, a way to find a block N1, which is slightly different, that will collide with it. But that only works for messages with a certain set of collisions. Certain set of conditions. A bunch of these are very easy to enforce, so you can like cause them manually by modifying the original message. I got this wrong multiple times when I did it originally. I got it wrong the first time because I couldn't figure out how you're supposed to modify N. The answer to that is this. Oh yeah, by the way, the MD4 algorithm is exactly what you expect it to be, is the usual iterated A, B, C, D, are UIN32s, and there are functions which are bitwise functions, F, G, and H, and you split the message into blocks, and then you do these operations, and pretty much that's it. And these are the initial values for A, B, C, D. We will ignore ripe MD. The notation we'll go back to look at later. But here is the differential. So here is the difference between N and M1. Took me forever to find this. These are all the bits you flip between the two messages. And what this means is, so the two messages, which are 16 bytes each, because 16 times 8 divided by 32 is the 4 32-bit words, which is the internal state. So it's a 128-bit hash function, like the challenge tells us, which should take 2 to the 64 to find collisions. Instead, we can do much better. So the difference between the first, the byte one of the new message and the byte one of the old message is 2 to the 31. So basically we are adding the top bit. The and same for the byte 2 and byte 12. So we modify only these bytes in the message. And we hash them both, and they end up colliding. If, and only if, these conditions at the end of the paper, in the table, are true. If all these conditions are true, which there's almost, I think, 50-something of them, each of them brings you one bit closer to the to a sure collision. I think they get to the point where you can get a collision in 2 to the 8 tries. But usually, if we only apply the first round worth of them, we can already get very close than with just pure brute force. Now, what I got wrong the first time is that I thought that the first round was this, and it really isn't. So first thing first, we need to understand MD4 well and inside out. I think we already implemented it. Didn't we? We did, okay. So, for our work, we only care about the actual MD4 block operation. And more specifically, only about one iteration, and even more specifically, only one round of it. Okay, so what's important to note here is that they rotate. So you do 16 operations, there will be various rotations. Now, for example, this is the new value for A1. The new A in the normal fashion. This code might be a little too optimized for us actually. Anyway, let's go back to the description of MD4. So we have this N XOR and OR operations and this negation. Each round of compression repeats 16 similar steps, and each chunk of message is used in 3 rounds. That's what tripped me up at the beginning too. Yeah, this function is doing a bunch of pre-computation. We can try writing out our own version and swapping it in. Anyway, let's focus on round one. Round one uses J0, which is this, which is exclusively function f. Functions f is this. X and Y not X and Z ordered together. But specifically, since we are at round 0, J0, the operation is always this one. So we can substitute to X B, to Y C, to Z D. And around is this. With rotating ABCD. So ABCD, DABC, CDAB, BCD, BCDA. Okay, and this notation is a way of representing a certain bit. So J will be 0, so it will be the first 32-bit word, And then for I will be, you know, first 4, then 8, then, yeah? And then, it will be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, etc., etc. So let's expand this, because this is one round, not this, is what I got wrong the first time. So this will start 0. So this will be the byte 0. This would be byte 1. Byte 2. Byte 3. And so it goes. Because in the notation, so this is actually terribly defined here. WJ comma 4i plus k is a message word? Okay, time to go look at what the actual code does. Where does the message come in? The message is P. So P is spread over So no, they're actually 32-bit words. Each of them is 4 bytes. You can see J, J plus 1, J plus 2, J plus 3 is the first word. Then J increases by 4, but that's just an implementation detail, because J actually increases by 1. Because here, then X is accessed as 1 through 16, because that's I. So the entire message, which is 64 bytes, because 32 divided by 8 is 4, and 16 of those is 64 bytes, each is 4 of them. So this is 0 to 4, 4 to 8, 8 to 12, 12 to 16. And they keep going. This is the same. Let's see in the actual code what the S ends up being. It seems pre-computed. Where is table 5? Okay. So this is the first round, and these are the differential, the step differences, which if you want to know how these lead to the conditions, you might want to read the paper. I'm not sure I understand it enough to explain it either. So one other way to put this is that then we rotate. Okay. Now, and this is rotation, by the way. Now we have to impose a bunch of these conditions. So for example, A1, so A at this stage, the 7th bit has to be equal to the 7th bit of B at the beginning. All of these conditions tend to be being equal to the previous or being zero, because here A is the one that was there before D. All of the C ones either depend on the D one before, or depend, or are just straight set to one, set to zero. So we have conditions set to zero, conditions set to one, and conditions set equal to the bit in the previous round. Which helps encoding that into a program. And for all of these, we can modify the message, since more and more pieces of the message are used going forward. We can just modify that part of the message to make that condition hold true. The second round would require being more careful. But here, for example, it suggests calculate the new value for A1 in the normal fashion, which is this value. So let's call them with their name. They are nice enough to go in order, as you see. A1, D1, C1, B1. A1, D1, C1, B1. A2, D2, C2, B2. A2, D2, C2, B2. So this paper, what it does is that it rotates the variables in the function. Otherwise, we can just rotate them in the code. But that's another place where I had gotten it wrong, I think. Use algebra. So we calculate A1 normally. Then we set A, enforce the condition to what we want it to be. For example, we know that A1 must have its seventh bit equal to the previous seventh bit. Seventh bit is the one at position 6, counting from 0. As you can see, this is one index because they hate us. And this here, there it's taking its XOR, shifting it by 6, and XORing it to A1, essentially making sure that they're equal. And then it's just reverting the function. How do we invert this function? Let's write the inverse of this function. The inverse of this function is that we take whatever the result was, oh, another consequence of how it rotates them here is that it always sets A, because A over time becomes different variables. But let's not do that. Essentially, we're going to unroll this loop so that it's more understandable. So how we invert this is that we take A, rotate it by S, subtract M, and subtract F of the others, which thankfully don't involve A, so we don't have to worry about much. Let's see if it matches. It says A1, we rotate it by that much. And then it subtracts n. Oh, no, we are solving for n, of course. We're trying to solve for this. So if we subtract the old A, the A as it was before, we obtain what n has to be for that to work. Let's double check it. We take this and then we set n in here to this. Remember that this is A0. a0 goes away with this a0. F goes away with this f. And this rotation goes away with this rotation. Modulo is not a problem because that's how we operate. So we get back a1. Perfect. So if we set m here to this value, we ensure that the result will be what we need to be. Okay, inverting the others is just as easy. Now it's time to code the conditions. Okay. I'm not sure exactly how we're gonna do it. So let's just start with something. We only care about doing round one here because this is the code that will patch the things. So let's copy from set four the code that chunks it up. As well as the initial constants. Checking that they're the same in the paper. They're not optimized with something or something. This is useful because it will allow us to test our self-test functions. We're going to write functions that check if the conditions are true, and then our functions that will check. Than before definition here. Okay, there, 6 7 blah 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 blah. Yes, actually we can copy paste this instead. Actually, let's just Hold on, gotta go open the space. Okay, so we now have A, B, C, D. And let's do the chunking. There we go. Okay, so we have this message, we have split it in words, and now let's write the various operations. Okay, again, a quick look at the old code to see how it does this. This is how they write it down. That's not what I have. I'm going to write it like they do. So rotation, let's copy paste that. Easy to get wrong. Okay. Okay. Alright, let's start making modifications later. First, it would be useful to know that this works. How the hell would we know that? Actually, don't know. I don't want to move on to conditions without knowing that this works. So let's instrument the set for code. Work as a test. Okay, so we know that this unlooped function, unlooped version of this function is correct because we tested it against the official MD4 block. Now we're going to need to do a few things. We're going to need to check conditions or enforce conditions. I think the way this will work is that none of this is going to be performance critical, I think. So I think we can take a callback. Yeah. I think we can take a callback. Also, let's start refactoring things we are too scared to refactor without tests. We can add something that after each operation, calls a certain function. Okay. So, the conditions. Oh no, this is AI in paper notation. How do we recover b zero here? Well, it's simply b. D only cares about the previous A, A1, which is the A that came out of here, so, and D that just got set. Here it only cares about C and the thing that just got set just before D, which is the thing at the position B, which I wonder why it always cares about the things at the position B. Possibly because they're the ones that influence both of the parts, I don't know. That's just the magic of it. And this B and C. A, D, C, B, A, D, C, B, A, D, C, B. Okay. Now this would be enough to check the collision, the conditions. So we're gonna need a format for the one conditions. Each thing can be either set to 0, 1, or previous. At each round, only the relevant one is affected. So we only need an index. And the type. So 16 rounds, 16 operations. Each with a list. Okay, this compiles. Now we have to manually copy them into this format. So the next one is 7 must be set to 0. Eight to previous. And 11 to previous. Done. 7, 8, 11, 26. 1, 1, 0 previous. 1, 1, 0 previous. Seven, eight, 11, 26. 1, 0, 0, 0. And I want this to align, so I'm gonna rename this P. Then 8, 11, 26, 14. 8, 1 there. 8, 11, 26, 14. 1, 1, 0 previous.14, 19, 20, 0 previous. 14, 19, 20, 21, 22, 26. Where the 26 is a 1, not a previous. 0, all previous, and a 1. 0, all previous, and a 1. I'm going to rename them W. (13 = 14, 0) (15 = 19, 0) 20, 0, 21, 1, 22, 0. 20, 21, 22. 13, 1, 14, 1. 15, 0. 17 = 19, 0. 20, 0. 21, 0. 22, 0. 13, 1, 14, 1. 15, 1, 17, 0. 19, 0, 20, 0. 21, 0. 23 = 22, 1, 26 equal? The good news is that we can test them by checking that the thing, the message they generated, has them all set. 13-1, 14-1. Thirty equal. Okay, they're getting shorter. Seventeen, 1, 20, 0. 21-0. 22-0. 23-0. 26-0. 31, 32 equal. Twenty, 0, 21, 1, 22, 1. 23 equal. 26-1. 30-0. 32-0. 4th of the last round. 23-0. 26-0. 27 equal. 29 equal. 31, 32-0. Twenty-three, 0, 26-0. 27-1. Knight g9 1. Thirty to one. 19 equal 23-1. Twenty-six-one. 27-0. 29-0. It's the last one. 19-0. 26 equal.
26 both equal and 1?
Oh yeah, because 26 in the previous one, we can encode it as whichever we want. 27-1. 29-1. 30-0. 30-0. And done. We have the conditions. Whew. So if we use the I index to find the conditions that need to apply to this one, then we do a switch based on the condition type. If it's W0, W1, WP, and the default where we panic. If it's 0, we ensure that that bit is 0. Counting how? Definitely minus 1. But judging from this challenge, it's little bit. Let's do a right shift. So this checks the conditions, and if they're not valid, returns false. So how do we use them? Like this. That way we cut this out and we make a fun check one conditions plural on a message. And instead of returning, okay, so this checks the conditions and it returns if any of them are invalid by passing the callback, which gets run after each round. Ooh. With the index of the position we are at, in every case. So in the test, we'll want to then let's go get the message from the paper. Okay, if it passes on this, we know we got the checks right. Wow! Typed those numbers right at the first No, it's the other way around. I'm checking the opposite condition again, am I not? Yeah. Yeah, okay. That sounded too good, didn't it? Okay, so something's wrong. Let's add print lines. So apparently all of them, which is impossible. So maybe it's not that ordering of bits. I remember having a lot of trouble with big endian and small endian. Let's start with 32 minus. Still nope. Okay. Bits. Let's say that we want the sixth bit. I think that's what they call seventh bit, right? Let's go look at the notation, which is different from the notation they use to describe the function itself, of course. Least significant bit is the first bit. So least significant bit is, for them is bit one. For us, that's, so if they say 7, because that's what they say in the first thing, right? Yeah. They mean right shift by 6. Yep, they do. Damn it. That's right. 6 because 7 minus 1, right shift by 6, and 1. Yeah. I love the fact that they're so, they know so well that they are doing endian is weird, that they give you the hash both in both endings. Because fuck us, that's why. So maybe this is not different endings, but who knows? This is reverting the endiness for sure. Oh, we can check what the hashing of it comes out as. Yeah, okay, that's a good check. We can run normal MD4 and see what if we get. Okay. Why does it start with the same? I don't want to ask. Okay. How do we even use MD4? Oh, new MD4. Wrong hash for paper message. There we go. Okay. Check some if I'm not wrong. Will do. This little engine. First, now this is big. Ah! Oh my God. Now this little engine, this is the one that doesn't make sense. First, the smallest one, and then the more and more important. Okay, so this is little endian. So probably the messages they gave us were big endian because fuck us, that's why. Yes! Okay, we have the conditions right, and I have to go open the door again, but yes. Okay. Yes, this is good. So we have all the conditions right and a way to check them. Now we need a way to enforce them. Okay. Now we're going to need an enforcer. It will work sooner. But in each case, we'll have to figure out the new value that it was supposed to have and fix the n such that it does have that value. With the magic of closures, it shouldn't require any change from this, except that it should be allowed to override what just happened. Okay, so enforcing requires figuring out what the message was supposed to be. No. Figuring out if we need to do a correction first. And if we do, we have the inversion function over here. Oh, but we need everything else to do the inversion. Ah. is about to become a huge thing. It should return A. That worked. Wow. Cool. Broke the check. How? No, okay, these are swapped. This is B and this is A. Yeah, it's from chat and email is suggesting that I'm returning A each time when it should be A, B, C, D. So what's very mind-bending is that these A, B, C, D don't map to toes A, B, C, D because they're called with the rotating A, B, C, D values. They are the ABCD values of this notation, but this is A at the second round, etc. And the we set it always to this, and the reason we're using A as 1 and B as 0 is that A is the one that we just computed. Well, B, which here is A, is one that we computed just before, because then we rotated right the variables by 1. It's awful, but it matches at least the notation of the paper, I suppose. Okay, we're back to pass. Now that we have all this information, we can reverse the function. So the order of operation is, we correct the erroneous bit, by modifying A, because that's what we'll be changing. The good thing is that the callback will also install the new value of A. So if we modify at the same time the message and A, we can just let the function keep going. So changing the bit involves taking 1, shifting it left this amount of times, and XORing it to A. In all cases, if the bit is wrong, we do this to correct A. And then we return A. But we can't stop there, we also have to fix the message. So the new N is this. Oh my god. Rotating right. Right. This. To go open the door, or someone else will go. Someone else will go. Good. Okay. And then we need to apply the function again. Which is this. Once we get the new n, we need to install it. Install it in little endian at the right position of the original message. I think the right position of the original message, which technically we have access to because we're in a closure, is I times 4, I think. Yes, because 16 times 4, yes. So it's binary dot little endian, if I'm not mistaken, dot put uint32 m1. And then we return A. In theory, this works. Let's see it. We enforce it on the random message we had. And see what happens. Yes! Okay, so we can enforce one conditions. We can check one conditions. Checking M1. Why does I do I always do this? Every time. Okay, so check false after enforcing. Wait, A0 is not what I'm saving. A0 is the A at the beginning. The A at the beginning of the operation. But by now, A has already been changed. Fuck. And and that's necessary because we are inverting it. So to invert it, we need to know the A like it was before the operation. This is awful. Okay. Now we're actually enforcing one conditions. Okay. I might want to go to dinner, and now I want to reach the point where I can try to collide, because it's not far. So now we just need to be able to modify the message. Wong sister message. Okay. And then we need to change just a few things. How do we apply that delta? So if M1 minus M is equal to this delta, which is the least useful notation, then to find M1, we do (2^31) plus M. If we take M, we add 2^31, the delta will be 2^31. Okay. Oh, here you count from zero, in which endiness. Oh, assholes. Wait, 2 to the 31. Oh, these are fucking words. These are words. Ah, these are words. Okay. There are 16 words, and for each of them we read the message in Big Endian because that's what they like. Okay, so we take the message from I times 4 onwards and we put it back and put the value back. If I is based on I, if I is 1, we need to add 2 to a 31, which is 1 shifted 31. To a 31 minus 2 to a 28. Okay, and if it's 12, it's minus 2 to the 16. Okay. So we write down what the M2 from the paper is. So we get M2. We generate the sister message for M1 ourselves. And we check that they're equal. Please, I don't want to deal with endiness. Of course, they're different. Are they not using Biolingen this time? I don't know. Also, this should be the other way around. Like copy and everything else. Nope. Because we swapped the endianness of M1. So maybe if we reverse it here too before. And then treat it all as little endian, which is probably not what they're doing. Pass. Okay. So we have a Wong sister message function that works on little endian messages, which is what we are used to deal with, and generates the exact same as the one in the paper. So we're ready to generate collisions. I can't believe it. Let's do the usual AES thing. And in a loop, we randomize the message. It's in 16 bytes blocks, so we need to do it 4 times. We set the Wong sister message. Which should be pretty fast because this, I think, gets optimized into a SIMD instruction. This is fast because it's fast. So once we have a sister message, we have a couple of MD4 objects. This might be the slowest thing, but for now we don't have a better option. Okay, now I'm gonna launch it with CPU profiling so that we also get some information. But I'm also gonna go eat now. It will probably time out at the 10 minutes. I'll try to come back in about 10 minutes, like let's say on the hour, and see if it worked. I doubt it will have worked just like that, but we can optimize it later. I think that we have all, we need. See you in a bit. No fucking way. In just 200 seconds? I was already expecting to have to write a main binary and export the functions so that we could run it on some EC2 machine or something. A lot of time on forcing. Okay, then I'm gonna change this a little to also test the collision. So cool. Okay, so we regenerate the sister message, we log it, we get the first hash, we log it, we get the second hash, and we make sure that the checksum is the same as the first hash. And let's run it again. Let's find another one, because why not? Also because I'm eating in the other room, so I like to run, let this run. Cool. Yes. All right. Wait, what? How did these two find the same? Oh, they're always finding the same because they always start the search from the same. I'm using a deterministic random number generator. Well, yeah, sure, why not? At least it's reproducible. And the test passed. This is the MD4 hash of both messages. Yes. All right. So this was faster than I expected it to be, because last time I had to run it overnight, but admittedly I was running it in Python and C extensions. But the code was not that much harder to write, which is the great thing about Go. And yeah, also this was on a single core. So yeah, this is good. This was very good. Okay, a few minutes early, but let's kick this across the finish line. Last one. We could optimize this, but guess what? We are not going to. it's weird that M4 is what is dominating, but nope. RC4, single byte biases. RC4 is a popular, extremely popular, finally extremely dead, wasn't even at the time the challenge was published, stream cipher. It's also susceptible to significant single byte biases. For a given position in the key stream, certain bytes are more or less likely to pop up than others. Given enough encryptions of a given plaintext, the attacker can use these biases to recover the entire plaintext. Statistically, the one shows up the most is the XORing of the one that you expect to be showing up the most. So, how useful are they? Well, folks, okay. Oh, the irony. It doesn't have TLS. Anyway, doesn't matter. There are spikes on Z16, Z32. These are the big ones. So here's the challenge. As usual, the code is and make an encryption oracle under a random key, just like when you make a new TLS connection every time. Every time a new key, and we send our request plus the cookie. So we launch arbitrary requests as usual. You know about this one. And in our request, we send the path, which is going to be, we can shift the position of the cookie under the bias by sending different paths. So let's try out an example request. Oh, it says that you can make it unrealistic where the cookie wouldn't be right at the beginning of the request like that. It's just an example, so. Just a scenario for where you'd be able to do this. Okay, so. The first thing we need to do is build accurate analysis of the biases. So, let's start low. Set 16 is key stream 15. Oh, this is not good. This is taking way too long. Oh, this is not good. If 2 to the 24 takes this long, 2 to the 30 is going to take forever. Damn. Damn it. This took way too long. All the time spent in making the new cipher. Because it's not optimized at all. Oh god damn it. In the graphs. So there should be a peak at 240, which we can already barely see. Is there anything else that high? Anything else that crosses 40? Yeah, so it might be already high enough. This is the highest by far. rc4 oracle. Read a secret. And which returns a nice function that takes a request. And returns an encryption. There we go. So this is our oracle. And okay, so We collect a bunch of samples of what the byte at position Z is. The one that comes up most often is probably plain text XOR 240, because what would come up most often in RC4 would be 240. So we can run it up to 14 times. How long is this? Is 30 bytes. We'll have to use the one at 32. Let's use the one at position 32. It doesn't seem as good. Also 30 because it's 32, the position we of the our peephole into the thing, plus 1 byte, 2 bytes that we can't avoid having at the beginning, so it's we can't see more than 30, extra more than 30. Okay, and it's running. I can probably make it about 3 times faster by using all the CPUs. Get to use sync.map. Optimized for a few steady state stores. No. We probably just want to slam. Lock on a map. 240 again? It's not 240. Yeah, it's 224. There we go. Yeah, 224. There we go. Okay. Let's try it out. Okay, we have our Oracle. all the usual shenanigans. This time we'll make it stop at 1. Because we want to read the profile to see if there's something we can do. So let's make this concurrent. E. Okay, that's believable. So this, as a brute force, is possibly the easiest to parallelize, because we just make, and since we know how many tries we have to make. So we spawn the goroutines, one for each Comax procs. And then we aggregate the totals. So what took a minute should now take a fourth of that, a third. So about 20 seconds. Yeah, it's spiking to all the CPU. Also because there are no locks here, because everything runs in parallel. But if we don't call wg.done, it will just stay there spinning. So yeah, when the CPU time reaches a minute, we should see a result. And it should get there much faster than in a minute. E, yes, consistently E. 30 seconds, we could do better. Let's see the CPU profile. Yeah, all the time spent in the Oracle, so we're not doing anything stupid. The time is still spent in that key schedule. A bunch of the time is spent in the actual C4 key stream, but yeah, almost all the time seems to be spent in the Oracle. Which in turn spends all the time in new cipher. Yeah. Pretty much nothing we can do. Yeah, this is pretty clear. Although there is a bunch of time spent sleeping, huh? Oh, but a lot of it is on malloc, comes from malloc anyway. And a bunch is from the scheduler. A bunch of it is not. A bunch of it is literally scheduling. Wow! It spends a lot of time scheduling. Why is that? It gets past a M which it owns. Each goroutine. Each goroutine is king of its own. M only accesses calls Oracle, but each separately, so why is spending so much time scheduling? Anyway, time to switch it up and see it happen, because here it passed midnight. Ooh, we could use 16 at the same time. Yeah. That's what we should do. Now we are talking. I don't know if you can hear it, but my laptop is seriously taking off at this point. So it's a race between me optimizing this and that finishing. Here's the only tricky part. The rest at position. -2 -request, so z1 -2 -len of request. Ooh, we got it wrong. It's set 2. XOR bias 1, and then we do it again. But this time with bias 2 and Z2. However, eventually this will go into negative, in which case we don't want to use it. Okay, we should see it start filling as soon as the first one happens. So it would be smarter to print the progress immediately too. You can see the two biases slowly making their way back. There we go. This is beautiful to watch. And we're also almost done. At midnight, at 12:30 on the day before I take an intercontinental flight. This is beautiful. Happening. It's probably a race with the 10 minutes limit on tests, to be honest. Last one. Set 7 done. 14 hours. Exactly half the last time. Gets, I guess, improvement. Alright. Time to ask me any questions before I get the hell out of here. Well, and thanks, Anthony, for $56 to the Internet Archive. Thank you. All right, since we're talking about it, I'm doing this also to raise money for the Internet Archive. The Set 8 in particular will try to be an actual, you know, keep going until donations come in sort of deal, because I have no idea how long it will take. If you make a donation and email in the description, you'll get thanked on stream. Also, while we're talking about description and chat, both in the YouTube description and in chat, you find an anonymous survey. It's super quick, you can skip anything that you don't feel like thinking about. It just helps me understand who's watching and how to make it better for people that are watching. Cool. Okay. I don't have much else. Last call for questions from chat. Alright, I am likely to upload this on Tuesday or something like that, because I will indeed be in London by then. But I will upload the code. Everyone, have a good night or whatever it is where you are. Filippo out.